When we look at the future, we can see how Indigenous people are leaders, innovators, and social change makers who are reclaiming cultural spaces and making room for one another in community, business, and government. What we are working towards is what the Cree call Minobimatsuin, living the good life. For Indigenous people, this means reclaiming identity, culture, language, and healing.
I think we need to normalize Indigenous youth leading the way and like getting the resources in their hands, you know, practice having their voices heard and having those voices be a part of important decisions that affect them.
In Winnipeg, we are seeing more Indigenous representation across the city, from our premier WAP canoe to the Manitoba Métis Federation at the corner of Portage and Main, to the Southern Chiefs Organization in the old Hudson's Bay Building, the Treaty One Nations in the Treaty One Development Corporation, and the return of land along Keniston Boulevard to become Naui Odena and Tagusigit, the Inuit Resource Center. Seeing yourself reflected across the city in these buildings and street names gives pride to Indigenous nations.
Currently, I work on Webene Bagakanagan, which means it is visible in Anishinaabe Mowin with Southern Chiefs Organization. I'm one of their Indigenous design leads, and I oversee a lot of their Indigenous involvement in terms of what the building looks like and feels like, and how does it represent their 34 Anishinaabe and Dakota First Nations. And so what I really hope this project produces is an Indigenous hub. And that's not something that you see very often within an urban center. You don't really see an entire building dedicated to all of the community supports that are required for First Nations people, such as residential living, assisted living for our elders, daycare that is specifically rooted in First Nations teachings and culture. There's also a ceremony involved, a commemoration circle to honor the children that did not make it home from residential schools, which is something that I'm leading personally as a First Nations person and also an intergenerational residential school survivor. There's also various elements of education, celebration, and honoring of First Nations people. And so what I specifically do is making sure that the community is listened to. I make sure that their voices are represented in what I design. I make sure that I do it in a very sensitive way in terms of speaking to youth, speaking to the elders, speaking to families, to make sure that this building specifically works for the members of our community. But it also serves as a model for other elements in other cities within and across Turtle Island of how our people should be represented, how our people should be listened to and advocated for.
There is great importance of creating spaces where Indigenous voices are valued and amplified. It is places such as the Winnipeg Art Gallery Humiuk, which celebrates the richness and diversity of art on these lands. Humiuk, meaning it is bright, it is lit in Inuktitut, is a powerful name that reflects the light of Inuit creativity and knowledge.
It's the world's largest Inuit art center located here. And it's a great place to come to see historical or really, really old Inuit carvings, art, you know, from different regions from the north. And the general public can go in there and learn a little bit more about Inuit. I am the founding member and chief executive officer for Western Canada's first Inuit Resource Center located here on Treaty One territory. The inception of Tungasugit Inuit Resource Center is what really paved the way for Inuit inclusion and various conversations that are happening in and around the city of Winnipeg. As a result of the tremendous amount of work that we do at Tungasugit with advocacy, language revitalization, cultural revitalization, giving to our community, their culture with all of the richness that they can take from that, you know, and being recognized by places like the city of Winnipeg, actually, to name a park after our organization speaks volumes. It shows that dedication to building those relationships with folks that they've never built relationships with, learn from each other, building those partnerships and having that conversation. My hope for the future for Inuit here in the city of Winnipeg, that Inuit are recognized as Canadians. We have supports that are put in place, whether that would be funding, core funding to help support the need for having the Inuit Resource Center here in Winnipeg, to feel that we are included in some of the decision-making aspects when it comes to Indigenous folks here in the city of Winnipeg, to be included into those conversations. I think the resurgence of our culture and our traditional ways of being will only amplify the beautiful connections that we can make and the beautiful things that can come out of that. So I really hope that really to be recognized, to be accepted, and to know that we are a distinct culture, but met by a lot of similarities within other Indigenous cultures.
For the next 150 years of this place, I have lots of dreams. I have dreams of sovereignty and more self-government, that we are able to kind of assert ourselves and our rights as Métis people to govern ourselves. That was one of the names that we had back in the day, the Otpemisiwak, so the people that own themselves, and to be able to do that again, I think would be incredible for our community. The Métis National Heritage Center that's being built and kind of revitalizing the old Bank of Montreal building right at Portage and Main. It's a really exciting project to just be able to drive down Portage and Main and see this like floral beadwork by Janine Crouchy that's going to be on the outside of that building. It's just really like this kind of beacon, I guess, for us. It'll be really exciting.
Winnipeg 150 represents to me an opportunity for Winnipeg to start again, to renew its relationship with all Indigenous people and really look at its systems, its policies, its practices to see how we can recreate a new vision that's inclusive of all people. Businesses and corporations can review their policies to see if they are open, welcoming, trauma-informed, that they in fact have Indigenous people that are part of their hiring practices, and to hire people into those organizations, because we know that when people are economically secure, then they can begin to make a difference. But when you're always living on the edge of poverty, not knowing, you know, where, how to feed your family, corporations can do that, businesses can do that, as well as governments need to really, frankly, consider implementing a universal basic income. I think it's important to kind of shift the conversation in that the burden of responsibility has been on the community and the community advocacy. I think that now is the time, Winnipeg 150, for the mayor and council and senior leadership within the city government to actually make the change, to take responsibility for making change.
Well, I think the best way of addressing attitudes is through education, through the education system. The way we educate children will ultimately be the way that we change the system. Because children in the future, going into the future, will better understand what their historical presence means, and also what their future obligations are. And then also children attending school will be able to learn to respect each other.
I think the non-Indigenous population within Winnipeg can support our young people is just through listening. We are very vocal in terms of what we stand for, about what we want, and at times we're put to the back burner in terms of the issues that we present. And so I think what I would like to tell those people is to listen. It's to stand there with us when we are on the streets, that they need to be there physically, but also advocate for us within their own respective fields. What I've always seen is that we say all these things, we do all these things, but there's no true action behind it, because it's those people within power or within these larger organizations that we need to stand up for us. We want to make change within our community, we just need to be given the support or the opportunity to do so. We are a beautiful people, paving the way in terms of architecture, in law, in filmmaking, in design, and various other fields. We're all being that trailblazer within these different aspects of our community, and that is something that should be highlighted. And this aspect of the negativity, we shouldn't be focusing on that entirely. Although there's like understanding of truth and reconciliation, but there's also an aspect of Indigenous joy where we are, in terms of our success, should be celebrated.
Diversity is like so important, and this inclusion. And we can see that in our environment when we look at forests, when we look at, you know, all these diverse parts of the ecosystem coming together, and each of those things give their all to nature to like all thrive. They give their all, you know. So I just think that diversity inclusion is so important that I hope and pray that they can make room in their hearts to learn more about us and like be open-minded, be open-hearted, and like come be around us and see that we're pretty good, you know? We're pretty good. And like what we do in our circles, these ceremonies we're talking about, these traditions, these programs, these all these things, they're meant to be inclusive. So I hope that they think about that, you know, think about diversity, not just on a people level, but just on a Mother Nature level, how important it is, and to keep that in mind.
Looking towards the next 150 years in Winnipeg, we need to acknowledge the ongoing challenges between Indigenous and non-Indigenous people and continue working towards reconciliation. Embracing the truths of our collective history, no matter how dark and difficult that is, will set a path for us, because we will know where we came from and learn how to look forward into the future together.